Audible Inc. presents Templeton's Way with Money, Strategies and Philosophy of a Legendary Investor, written by Jonathan Davis and Alasdair Nairn, narrated by Alex Hyde-White. Introduction. Sir John Templeton was, by common repute, one of the most successful and best-known professional investors of the past 100 years, as well as an outstanding philanthropist, knighted by the Queen of the United Kingdom in 1987 for his many years of charitable work. Forbes magazine dubbed him the Dean of Global Investing, in recognition of the trail he blazed in seeking to invest across the world when others were too afraid to do so. Louis Rukeyser, host of Wall Street Week, a popular network television program on which Templeton appeared many times, said that this quiet, deeply religious man was one of the genuine heroes of Wall Street. Prem Watsa, a Canadian fund manager, described Templeton more recently as a wonderful man and, for all practical purposes, perhaps the greatest investor of all time. The detailed research we publish in this book confirms that John Templeton was indeed one of the very few professionals who can rightly claim, hand on heart, to have consistently obtained the holy grail of stock market investment, above average returns with below average risk. In his case, this was a record that he sustained for the best part of half a century. His best-known mutual fund, the Templeton Growth Fund, never once in 38 years under his guidance failed to deliver a positive, real, inflation-adjusted return over any 60-month period. This is a record that only a handful of other professional investors can claim to have achieved over such a long period. 4 years after his death, Templeton's name and investment philosophy live on around the world through a wide range of funds that either carry the Templeton name or claim to use his methods. Many billions of investors' money is today managed on the basis of the simple but profound principles first laid down by a man who stands comparison with Warren Buffett, George Soros, Peter Lynch, and a handful of others as one of the all-time greats of the modern investment world. The reason for this enduring legacy is simple. His investment methods have stood the test of time. They work. And in this book, timed to coincide with the 100th anniversary of his birth, we set out to explain what those methods were, the truth about his track record as an investor, there are a number of surprising myths, and why and how his methods continue to be relevant today. Given how many words have been written already on the subject, it is legitimate to inquire whether the world needs a further book on the Templeton approach to investment. We asked ourselves the same question when we originally considered embarking on this project. Amazon, the online bookseller, lists no fewer than 50 books, for example, about Templeton's life, investment approach, and spiritual concerns. We came to the conclusion, however, that there is still room in the market for a single-volume, independent assessment of Templeton's investment methods and philosophy, written from a professional rather than a religious, philanthropic, or family perspective, and with the future, not the past, in mind. These are the main reasons why we believe that a single-volume study that seeks to encapsulate the essence of John Templeton's investment wisdom is both fresh and timely. Number one, a fresh perspective. Some of the many books published about Templeton's life and methods in the past have verged, we think it is fair to say, on hagiography. Many seem to have been written to advance his philanthropic and religious interests rather than primarily to enlighten investors. Others are either out of print or sponsored works by close associates, published with the assistance of one of Sir John's charitable foundations. This one, in contrast, aspires to be an independent and objective contemporary assessment by two investment professionals with many years of direct experience in the investment business. The 10 years that one of the authors, Sandy Nairn, spent working directly for Sir John, have given us additional first-hand insights into what his approach to investment means in practice. Number two, access to new material. We are fortunate to have had access to a considerable amount of previously unpublished information. This includes copies of the letters that Sir John wrote to his investors and clients over the course of 50 years, as well as detailed data and analysis of his performance record that have not been professionally published before. In 1993, Mark Holowesko, then Chief Investment Officer of Templeton's fund management business, began the practice of circulating around the offices of the Franklin Templeton Group copies of internal memos and letters the firm's founder had written in the past. They proved popular with the firm's employees and remain an invaluable source of insight into his thinking. We reproduce some extracts in the body of this audiobook as well as in the appendix. As with the essays of Warren Buffett, the clarity and insights that characterize Templeton's writings instruct as well today as they did at the date of origin. Number three, timeless lessons. Sir John's philosophy of investing, which is built around the presumption that investors must have the courage and patience to ride out economic and market cycles and stick to a rigid investment discipline, remains highly relevant today. Twice already this century, from 2000 to 2003, and again from 2007 to 2009, investors have experienced savage bear markets in which stock markets around the world have fallen, peak to trough, by around 50%. Many investors remain shell-shocked and disillusioned by the losses they have incurred as a result. Had they followed a disciplined Templeton approach, we can show that they would not have fared nearly as badly as many did. Nor, we can say with confidence, would they have become so disheartened. John Templeton was an optimist by temperament, but like many great investors, saved his best investment performance for bear markets, underlining the fact that success in investment is just as much about avoiding losses and preserving what you have gained as it is about picking winners. Number four, methods that work. Sir John's track record as an investor, as we have noted, is remarkable not just for the consistent returns that he produced for his clients and fund investors, but also for their below-average risk. $10,000 invested in the Templeton Growth Fund, his first mutual fund at its launch in 1954, would have grown to $1,736,100, 38 years later. The fund outperformed the equity market for four decades at a compounding rate of more than 3.7% per annum. In investment terms, where investment genius is typically measured in fractions of a percentage point of superiority against the market averages, this margin of outperformance constitutes a genuinely extraordinary track record. Standard financial theory holds that such a sustained period of outperformance can only have been achieved by luck or by the fund manager taking additional risk. Yet, as we will demonstrate, the fact is that the Templeton Growth Fund produced its exceptional performance with less, rather than more, risk than the average fund. As a value investor, John Templeton's approach to markets was rooted in the simple but powerful idea that buying assets for less than they are worth is the most certain and the least risky path to superior investment returns. We demonstrate with original research why these methods do indeed work, why they are so often misunderstood, and why so many investors in practice fail to take advantage of them. Number five, current opportunities. We believe it is important for investors today to appreciate that the events of the past 10 years that encompass the internet bubble and its consequences, the tragic drama of 9/11 and the Iraq War, as well as the great global financial crisis of 2008 and its aftermath, reinforce the importance of some fundamental truths about investment. One is that there are always opportunities to make money, even when the outlook appears particularly gloomy. One of Sir John's favorite maxims was that the time to invest is at the point of maximum pessimism. Despite, or perhaps because of, having lived through the Great Depression during his formative years, he himself, by virtue of his temperament and personal faith, retained an unshakable faith in the capacity of mankind to rise above adversity, which he was confident would, in due course, be translated into attractive investment returns. In the final part of this audiobook, we look at where some of the best long-term opportunities now appear to lie. Number 6. Morally defensible investing. After the collapse of Enron, the uncovering of Bernie Madoff's vast Ponzi scheme, and the excesses of bankers during the recent credit crisis, investors' faith in the institutions that look after their money has been badly shaken. John Templeton's life and career is a timely reminder that success on Wall Street, in the City of London, and in other financial centers can be achieved without sacrificing the old-fashioned virtues of courage, honesty, and integrity that now appear to be so regularly and so blatantly disregarded in the financial industry. Throughout his professional career, initially as an investment counselor and later as a fund manager, Templeton demanded and set the highest professional standards. As a matter of personal habit, he was invariably punctual, courteous, and polite. And in a business career spanning more than 60 years, he took comfort in never having been sued and in never, knowingly at least, having made an enemy. Number 7, an inspirational life. It is important, finally, not to lose sight of the fact that John Templeton's life and career are evidence of the importance of personal commitment and endurance in the face of adversity. The young man from Winchester, Tennessee, had to overcome many obstacles and setbacks on the way to acquiring the exalted reputation and wealth of his later years. When he was an undergraduate, at the height of the Great Depression, his father told him that he could no longer afford to finance his university education. Templeton was forced to scratch around to find the means to pay his own way and complete his education. 23 years later, his first wife was tragically killed in a motor accident, leaving him for several years alone with 3 young children to bring up on his own. Although his greatest financial success came only after the age at which many people have retired, his story remains an inspiration to anyone who wants to believe that it is possible to become wealthy and lead a fulfilling life at the same time. The year 2012 marks the 100th anniversary of Sir John Templeton's birth. He was 42 years old when he launched the Templeton Growth Fund, his first mutual fund, and the vehicle that was eventually to make him both fabulously wealthy and internationally famous. When the fund was launched, he had already been an investment counselor for 16 years, one known to his clients as a shrewd and sensible advisor, but still relatively unknown to the wider investing public. Whereas today there are thousands of funds in which investors can choose to place their money, in 1954 the new fund was a genuine innovation, being one of the first of its kind to offer insular North American investors exposure to a diversified portfolio of non-U.S. stocks within a tax-efficient mutual fund structure. Having sold his original investment advisory business in the early 1960s, Sir John was directly responsible for the management of the Templeton Growth Fund from its launch until he and his partners sold the Templeton Fund Management business to Franklin Resources in 1992, by which time its assets under management had grown to $21.3 billion. In 1987, he handed over day-to-day responsibility for stock selection to his assistant, Mark Holowesko, but retained a watching brief over the portfolio. 20 years after he sold and retired from the business that he had created, the Templeton Growth Fund and its many offshoots remain among the world's largest equity funds. The family of emerging market funds that John Templeton set up in 1987, in another of his far-sighted business decisions, alone accounted for $40 billion of assets under management in 2011. The track record of the fund's management team, led by Dr. Mark Mobius, has demonstrated the efficacy of his mentor's methods. In the 10 years to November 2011, the original Templeton Emerging Markets Investment Trust has outperformed its Morningstar benchmark by 4.3% per annum. The net asset value of the EP Global Investment Trust, managed by one of the authors, has similarly outperformed the MSCI World Index by 3.3% per annum since its launch in December 2003. After his retirement from the fund management business, Sir John devoted most of his time for the rest of his life to his philanthropic and religious work. His primary focus in the later years of his life became his Christian faith and the affairs of the Templeton Foundation, whose endowments he continued to watch over with an eagle eye. Funded by his considerable personal fortune, the foundation gives away more than $50 million per annum in grants, gifts, and other forms of financial assistance. It continues to fund an annual prize to reward those who have pioneered scientific research into spiritual phenomena. The Templeton Press has published scores of books and articles that emphasize the importance of spiritual development. While his faith was a central part of his life, his religion plays only a tangential part in this book, which deliberately focuses solely on his investment career and beliefs. Right up until his death at the age of 95, Sir John continued to study investment trends and followed financial events around the world with an unswerving attention to detail. His eye for a bargain remained as keen as ever. During one of our conversations in the initial research for this book, we mentioned the fact that some privately owned businesses in the United Kingdom were then selling very cheaply, at 2 to 3 times earnings. "Gee," he replied, quick as a flash, "I would be interested in hearing more about those. Can you send me some details?" He was 91 at the time. At the same time, his sense of the many risks confronting the world remained acute. As early as 2003, for example, he was expressing his concern to us about the bubble that was developing in the property market on both sides of the Atlantic. This was fully 4 years before the subprime mortgage crisis was to send the housing market in the United States into a tailspin and the world financial system into its worst crisis for more than 70 years. This crisis was one that John Templeton publicly identified in advance. Just as 20 years earlier he had correctly and publicly forecast both the onset of the great stock market boom of the 1980s and 1990s and the investment potential of emerging markets. Such global awareness was one of the key factors behind his impressive track record as an investment advisor and fund manager, and the reason that his public pronouncements were so widely followed for so many years. The purpose of this book is to explain, as clearly as we can, the lessons and implications that we believe can be drawn from Sir John Templeton's life, experience, and investment wisdom. As such, it is not a biography, nor is it simply an analysis of what he said and did, although the book inevitably has elements of both. We would like to think of it more as a handbook for those who are interested in understanding and applying the philosophy of investment that John Templeton developed and practiced for so many years. Such an understanding is relevant to both private and professional investors, from whatever part of the globe they come. Because he spoke so much sense and had an uncanny ability to express himself in simple language, it has proved impossible not to quote liberally from his own writings and observations. The book is structured as follows. Chapter 1 reviews the story of John Templeton's life and career. This has been told many times, but we are able to add some new detail, correct one or two myths, and draw on original interviews with a number of those who worked closely with him. Chapter 2 provides fresh insight into the way that Templeton, in the first stage of his professional career, operated as an investment counselor, quoting liberally from previously unpublished letters to clients and memoranda to his colleagues. In Chapter 3, we look in detail at the track record of the Templeton Growth Fund and attempt to answer the question, just how good was he as a fund manager? We also analyze when and under which conditions his fund achieved its outperformance. Chapter 4 returns to the main themes of his investment philosophy and how he applied them. We look at the difficulties and challenges of applying his investment philosophy and process in practice, contrasting the way that he went about his decision-making with that adopted by most investors. In Chapter 5, we demonstrate, with the help of an exhaustive proprietary study of market behavior in 35 countries, why his particular analytical methods were, and remain, conducive to producing superior long-term returns. In Chapter 6, we summarize our conclusions and look back at recent market experience, attempting to interpret what has happened from a Templeton-esque perspective. We conclude with an assessment of the investment opportunities and threats that face investors today. The appendix contains a selection of memos written by John Templeton that we think will be of interest to the student of his methods and beliefs. Other memos from the same source, which we do not include, can be found on the Independent Investor website, www.independent-investor.com/Templeton-memos. The idea for this book was not his, and Sir John did not, sadly, live to review our manuscript. Although he gave the project his blessing and encouraged us to speak to his associates, this is not an officially authorized account of his life and methods. It may be worth emphasizing that we have neither sought nor received any financial support from either his family or his foundation. We are grateful, however, to the executors of his estate for permission to quote from his memoranda and letters, and to all those who agreed to speak to us about their experiences working with him. All matters of interpretation remain our responsibility. In particular, we would emphasize that in the final section of the book, where we examine the current outlook for investors from a Templeton perspective, the views are of necessity our own, rather than his or those of the Franklin Templeton Group. For stylistic reasons, we have found it easier to refer throughout the book to our subject either as John Templeton or simply Templeton, and only exceptionally as Sir John, the honorary knighthood bestowed on him in his 70s. We are open to receiving comments and other source material from those who worked with this great investor during his life, and will endeavor to incorporate them in future editions. Jonathan Davis, Alasdair Nairn, London and Edinburgh, December 2011. Chapter 1. The Man and His Life. The story of how a precocious young man from Winchester, Tennessee, grew up to become one of the most respected and wealthy professional investors of all time has been told many times, so much so that, as with many rich and successful men, discovering where the legend and the truth diverge is not always straightforward. John Templeton was a man of the highest personal integrity, but some of the stories about his rise to fame and fortune have, one suspects, lost something in the telling over the years. To judge by some of the conflicting details in different accounts of his life, certain facts have, with the passage of time, been either gilded for the benefit of effect, forgotten, or mixed up with one another. It is generally true that hindsight tends to make an individual's path to success appear smoother and more certain than, in reality, it was at the time. There is no doubt that John Templeton himself was fully aware of the importance of storytelling in building and sustaining an aura around his life and business success. Although shy by nature, he was an accomplished user of the media to advance his business career. A tireless publisher of books about his investment ideas and religious and philanthropic interests, and as a man, for all his genuine humility, not wholly immune to a certain amount of vanity. He had a sense of humor, but was not the kind of man to tell jokes. Yet there is no gainsaying the extent of his achievements or his remarkable record as a pioneer and exponent of the art of disciplined investment, an art he practiced and sustained over more than three generations. What is not in doubt is that, rather like Warren Buffett, another of the 20th century's greatest investors, John Templeton was brought up with an unshakable determination to succeed. His self-assurance, allied to an unrelenting capacity for hard work and the ability to reduce complex analytical issues into a framework of simple but reliable heuristics, was instrumental in enabling his later triumphs as a professional investor. Determination and self-assurance were etched into his character from an early age. As a young boy, encouraged by his parents to be resilient and to show initiative, he showed a keen interest in enterprise. At the age of 8, according to one of his earliest biographers, he was ordering fireworks from a manufacturer and selling them to other boys at his school for profit. As a teenager, unable to afford a car, he cannibalized the parts of 2 wrecked Fords, bought for $10 each, to create one vehicle in which he was able to drive himself and his friends around for the next 4 years before selling it at a profit. When his school was unable to offer him the math instruction he needed to get into Yale, his chosen university, he persuaded the head teacher to allow him to teach an extra class in geometry and trigonometry himself, learning as he went along and ending, perhaps unsurprisingly, with the highest marks in the exam. His drive to succeed faced its most severe test in the grim Great Depression year of 1931, when his father had to tell him that he could no longer support him in his undergraduate studies at Yale. The 19-year-old Templeton, by then in the second year of an undergraduate degree course in economics, had suddenly to find other ways to finance his studies. Recalling this early crisis many years later, he said, "At the beginning of sophomore year," which was 2 years after the great stock market crash in 1929, "my father told me with regret that he could not contribute even $1 more to my education. At first this seemed to be a tragedy, but now looking back, it was the best thing that could have happened. It caused me to begin studying really hard to get top grades and thereby maintain 2 scholarships to help with the expenses." It also impressed on him that hard work and self-reliance were the keys to survival in life. "Seeming tragedy can be God's way of educating his children," he observed later. "Mother had saved a little cash from selling vegetables and eggs, and I borrowed $200 from my Uncle Watson, which Mother paid back years later. This enabled me to travel to New Haven and to apply to the very well-organized Yale Bureau of Student Employment, which was run by a capable man named Ogden Miller, who later became headmaster at the Gunnery School. He helped me to get scholarships and also to earn money at various jobs, such as being senior aide of Pearson College and a chairman of the Yale Banner and Potpourri yearbook. In addition to these worthy endeavors, Templeton took to playing poker with his fellow students to make up the shortfall in his funding. This despite the fact that in his later professional life, he was to bar his colleagues from investing in gaming stocks, as well as tobacco and drinks companies, on ethical grounds. Templeton estimated that he managed to earn enough from the poker table, using his knowledge of probability and his native quick wits, to pay for 25% of his fees. His remaining financial needs were met by a combination of the loan from his uncle, scholarships, and jobs at the university. His time at Yale also saw him make his first stock market investment. "As a senior at Yale," he told his colleague and biographer Robert Herman, "I earned $1,000 as the first senior aide of Pearson College. That was a tremendous help because it covered one half of all that year's expenses. When the 1934 accounting for the Yale yearbook was finished, about $800 in profit was distributed to me as chairman and was used to open an account with my roommate, Jack Green. He was then senior partner of a stock brokerage firm in Dayton, Ohio, called Green and Ladd because his father had died during Jack's junior year at Yale. This account is now 42 years old, but the name of the firm has changed to Cowan and Company. My first purchase of any stock was the $700 preferred stock of Standard Gas and Electric Company, which was selling at 12% of par because of the Great Depression. From that original $800 and later savings have grown all of the investments I now own." By this time, Templeton had already decided that he wanted to go into the investment business. After majoring in economics and collecting his degree from Yale in 1934, he won a Rhodes Scholarship to Oxford to study law for 2 years. At this most prestigious of English universities, he was taught by a law don at Balliol College, there being at that date no specialist tutors in business, let alone the lesser subject of finance. The idea that investment might become a distinct academic discipline was still many years in the future. Benjamin Graham's seminal textbook, Security Analysis, written with David Dodd, had been published in 1934. But John Burr Williams's Theory of Investment Value, another landmark in the development of financial analysis, did not appear until 1938, having originally been written as a thesis at Harvard University. Although he had certainly read Graham's Security Analysis, which he later described as the best book ever written on investment, we do not know whether Templeton was familiar with the writings of John Maynard Keynes, whose most influential work, His General Theory of Employment, Interest, and Money, was published in England during the 23-year-old Rhodes Scholar's final year at Oxford. The General Theory contains some of the most famous passages ever written about the practice of investment, but if Templeton did read it, it seems that the world's most widely quoted economist failed to leave much of an impression. We have failed to find a single line of Keynes or any reference to him in any of the scores of memoranda, articles, or press interviews in the Templeton archives. Having finished his studies at Oxford and before returning to New York to start his career, Templeton decided to take 7 months to travel across Europe and Asia on a shoestring budget with a university friend, James Inksetter. During the course of this trip, he and his companion visited no fewer than 27 countries, observing the rise of Hitler at the Berlin Olympics and acquiring early experience of the world outside the United States. This experience was to stand him in good stead in his later career as an exponent of global investing, of which he was to become such a prominent pioneer. There were few countries with significant stock markets that he had not visited before he set up shop as an investment counselor, a discipline in which his knowledge and experience of other cultures and economies was evident from an early stage. The countries he visited for the first time included India, China, and Japan. In his own words, "I finished Yale in summer 1934, so I was in Oxford for 2 years after that. Oxford, I found, was so different from American universities. They gave me 6 weeks holiday at Easter and 6 weeks holiday at Christmas, and we Americans there took full advantage of that. I spent the second 6 weeks learning all I could about Germany, including listening to Hitler. I didn't meet him, but I did listen to him. It was a build-up to war, but it didn't really involve America until Hitler invaded France." Many years later, Templeton returned to Oxford to found Templeton College, the first college in the university to be devoted to full-time management education. Into the investment business. The first job that Templeton found on his return to the United States was as a trainee at Fenner & Bean, a stock brokerage that was later absorbed into Merrill Lynch. After only 3 months, he was offered a much better paid job as treasurer at an industrial company, which sent him to Chicago, Dallas, and then back to New York. 2 years later, age 26, and by now married, he was ready to take the plunge and leave his job to set up his own investment advisory firm, which had long been his ambition. He later acquired the business of an elderly investment advisor in New York for $5,000 and set up office in the newly completed Art Deco skyscraper Radio City, now better known as Rockefeller Center. The purchase of the business was funded in part by a $10,000 loan from his former boss at Fenner & Bean. The loan was repaid after a year. It was the only time in his life that Templeton, who abhorred debt and strongly advised against its use for stock market speculation, says he had been seriously in debt to anyone. The loan from his uncle that helped him to complete his studies at Yale was, as we have seen, later repaid by his mother. Templeton's own account of his earliest professional experience is as follows. 3 months after I went to Merrill Lynch, one of my first mates was a Rhodes Scholar at Oxford, who said that he was vice president of an oil exploration company, and they had an opening for a treasurer. They offered me more than double what Merrill Lynch was paying me, and I thought I needed practical experience in how corporations operate, so I resigned from Merrill Lynch and was shifted by this exploration company, first to Chicago and then to Dallas and then back to New York. That took a little over 3 years. At the end of 3 years, I owned some shares in my employer. I bought out the shares, which they helped me buy, and that gave me enough money to live for 5 years without income. The truth is that I started out my life with no money whatever. I made my own way through Yale and with scholarships through Oxford. This was true, although it would not be strictly correct to say that he came from a poor family. As he noted, once he had decided to set up his own firm, Templeton was not, in the early years, always able to draw a salary. 2 years after acquiring the first investment counseling business and getting his name above the door for the first time, he merged it with another larger firm to create a new firm, Templeton, Dobro, and Vance, in which he retained a substantial majority shareholding. Given his other commitments, it was perhaps just as well that the frugality for which he was to become well known was already much in evidence. He and his first wife, Judith Dudley Folk, whom he had married in 1937 after a 3-year engagement, vigorously embraced thrift as a way of life, furnishing their house with second-hand furniture bought at auction. She found a job in advertising, and together they made a pledge to save, as a matter of policy, half of their joint incomes every month. There are once again parallels with Warren Buffett, one of many successful investors for whom thrift is, or has become, an ingrained habit. To make thrift a joy rather than a burden, we made a game of it by telling our plan to all friends and relatives, who then gave us ideas. We found a furnished Manhattan apartment with a view of the East River for $50 monthly. Our friends helped us find blue plate dinners and restaurants for 50 cents. In 1940, the only Manhattan apartment we could find for $50 was on the 6th floor of a no-elevator building on East 88th Street. To furnish 5 rooms, we could budget only $25. Our friends watched newspapers for furniture auctions when people were moving away. At such auctions, if anyone bid $1 for a chair, we said nothing, but if no one bid, we said 10 cents. Our costliest purchase was $5 for a $200 sofa bed, which was so good, we used it for 25 years. With such joyous games, as Templeton described this self-imposed frugality, he and his wife furnished the apartment within the $25 budget. His tightness with money is a recurring theme in all his future professional colleagues' accounts of their time working with him. A stock market coup. A second important episode in the Templeton story is that his first serious step as an investor was to decide, in 1939, just as World War II was breaking out, to go out and buy, sight unseen, all the stocks on the big board of the New York Stock Exchange that were priced at $1 or less. There are different versions of this story in print, but in the one that reads best, he even declined his broker's offer to give him the names of the stocks he was buying. His argument was that the stock market was due for a recovery, and that even the most uncompetitive companies were likely to do well on the back of the stimulus provided by the inevitable increase in government spending that would be necessitated by the outbreak of war. So sure of his thesis was he that he did not even need to know the names of the stocks he was buying. Templeton himself recalled this extraordinary stock market foray many years later. "The very day that happened, the German invasion of Poland, I said to myself, that if there's ever a time when corporations that are struggling come back to life is during a war. Following the Great Depression, there were more than 100 stocks on the New York Stock Exchange that had gone down to less than $1 a share, so I called up Merrill Lynch and said, 'Buy me $100 of everything below $1 a share.' That proved to be very lucky. Within 4 years, I had 4 times my money." It is perhaps open to later generations to doubt whether this simple account of nerveless, youthful investment genius was quite the whole story. Throughout his life, Templeton was renowned for the thoroughness of his research, and indeed it was his study of previous episodes in financial history that had led him to conclude that low-priced stocks were likely to do better during the kind of wartime stock market recovery that he was expecting. It seems implausible, given the scale and audacity of this speculative investment that he was making, that he was not fully aware of the names of many, if not all, of the stocks he had instructed his broker to buy. Further, it is not wholly convincing that he made his decision entirely on the spur of the moment. The very day that Hitler invaded Poland, as his later telling of the story seems to imply. It is worth recalling, too, that in today's money, the $10,000 investment would be the equivalent of more than $150,000. Such a sum was many times the average income of the average American citizen, and twice the amount Templeton himself was about to pay to establish a foothold in the investment counseling business. For a young man of 27, it was certainly an audacious move, not least because it was effectively funded with debt, in the form of the $10,000 loan he had earlier taken out from his former boss in stockbroking. No fewer than 37 of the 104 stocks that the brokers acquired on his behalf were already in bankruptcy. It is tempting to say that few investments could have been more speculative or less typical of the disciplined methods that Templeton was to advise others to pursue in his later career. Although he was to become renowned in his later career as a long-term investor who never failed to extol the virtues of patience and an even temperament, it is fascinating to speculate how much equanimity in practice a young married man, even one as self-confident as Templeton, was able to muster as he waited for his massive, speculative gamble to play out. Did doubts enter his mind at any point during the 4 years he held onto his portfolio of third and fourth-rate stocks? It is worth remembering that his investment decision was, not for the first time in his career, well ahead of events. His $10,000 purchase of stocks was made more than 2 years before the Japanese raid on Pearl Harbor, which was the trigger for President Roosevelt to take the Americans into the war, something many of the Allies on the other side of the Atlantic, from Winston Churchill down, were far from convinced was going to happen. If, as he later recalled, the $10,000 loan was repaid within a year, it seems unlikely that this could have been solely the result of any rapid increase in the value of his stock portfolio. Although the price of stocks on Wall Street rose on the day that Germany invaded Poland, and again the day afterward, they did not break out decisively above their level on September 3, 1939, for more than 3 years. The Dow Jones Index fell by 12.7% in 1940, and by 15.4% in 1941. It was not until April 1942, 5 months after Pearl Harbor, that the stock market finally began the significant wartime rally that Templeton said that he was expecting to follow the outbreak of war. The index did not surpass its level on the day Britain declared war on Germany until after the invasion of Normandy in June 1944. 4 years on from his original purchase on September 1, 1943, the Dow Jones Industrial Average was less than 2% higher than it had been on the day he made his first investment. Of course, many individual stocks fared much better than the average. There were good reasons for believing that near-bankrupt companies would fare better than the averages. For his portfolio to rise by 100% in 12 months in a flat market and by 300% over 4 years, as his account suggests, was therefore a remarkable achievement. A more realistic assessment may be that his analysis, as was true so often in his career, was correct, but that his decision to invest was some years ahead of events. The outbreak of World War I had been followed by a surge in the American stock market, but after an initial 2-day rise, this was not what happened in 1939. The assumption was wrong. Many years later, in a letter to his clients, Templeton noted how many weak or failing companies had subsequently produced exceptional results. Wartime saved many companies that otherwise might not have survived. The worse their balance sheets were, the more leverage they enjoyed. More than 200 companies had risen by 20-fold or more in the previous 20 years. Yet it is notable that most of these companies had experienced their lows in 1941, not in 1938. In other words, while Templeton was vindicated by later events, the timing of his speculative foray, so different from his later investment style, was distinctly premature. Investment counselor. Recalling his early days as an investment counselor in an interview 60 years later, he said, "When I opened my office in Radio City, I must say I made a lot of mistakes. Perhaps the biggest mistake of all is to start out like a law firm does or like a medical firm does and hope that your reputation alone will attract customers. I tried that, In fact, that was the standard among investment counselors. When I started out, I would have been looked down on if I had done any advertising. The result was that it took a long time to accumulate clients. Now that it is acceptable to be a salesman, I would surely think you ought to spend three-quarters of your time selling. This was a theme, as we shall see, which was to recur when Templeton later moved into the mutual fund business. Sometime after opening his office in New York, in order to save money, he moved the bulk of his operations to the suburb of Englewood, New Jersey, 45 minutes away from the center of Manhattan. Throughout the 1940s and 1950s, Templeton and his partners continued to build up their investment advisory business. Wartime and the subsequent Cold War provided early lessons in the wisdom of controlling clients' exposure to the stock market. Templeton was one of the first firms to attempt to regulate clients' exposure to the market on the basis of a quantitative assessment of the current level of the market, an approach that came to be known as the Yale or Vassar method, and which we describe in more detail in the next chapter. The key elements of this method were to reduce market exposure when it had become overvalued and increase it when it became undervalued against historical experience. Nothing sounds simpler or more logical. Buying low and selling high has been the street trader's watchword since markets began. It is, however, something that most investors find much harder to achieve in practice than it should be. Templeton's analysis was based on comparing the level of the market in a rigorous fashion with the earnings, cash flow, and yield characteristics of both the recent and more distant past. It proved to be a useful tool that, by his own account, was to help steer the firm's clients safely through the bear markets of the late 1940s and 1950s, while inevitably sacrificing some of the upside in the stock market's best years. It was only later that he was to develop the practice of basing his individual stock selection on forward rather than historic earnings. The fund management business. In 1954, looking for new ways to expand the business more quickly, Templeton decided to launch a new mutual fund. This was the Templeton Growth Fund, domiciled in Canada. It was unusual in being one of the very first mutual funds to offer North American investors the opportunity to invest in a managed fund that set out to invest across the globe. At the time, it was still a commonplace view among investment professionals that it was too risky to commit anything but a small proportion of their assets to investment opportunities outside the United States. In addition, legislation prevented many pension funds and charitable foundations from investing in securities outside the United States. The fund itself was the first of a number of new managed funds to be domiciled in Canada, where there was no capital gains tax. The tax advantages of the fund had obvious advantages to a U.S. investor, and they duly featured prominently in the way that the fund was marketed. Behind those immediate benefits, however, were the seeds of a distinctive new investment philosophy. Templeton's argument, still a minority view at the time but now mainstream thinking, was that widening the range of potential investment opportunities could only increase the universe of potential bargains to the benefit of investors. His view had always been that the risk of global investing is exaggerated and can, in any event, be offset by diversification. Research shows that a stock portfolio with investments around the world is likely to yield, in the long run, a higher return at a lower level of volatility than will a simple, diversified, single-nation portfolio. Diversification should be the cornerstone of any investment program. It is a neat coincidence that the Templeton Growth Fund was launched just as the future Nobel Prize winner Harry Markowitz was demonstrating that diversification across poorly correlated asset classes could reduce investors' exposure to risk without jeopardizing returns, an insight that underlies much of modern financial theory. For many years, investor interest in the Templeton Growth Fund was limited. Its performance was strong in absolute terms, capitalizing as it did on the 1950s post-war recovery in equities, but it remained little known and poorly followed. For the first 10 years, as we show in Chapter 3, it would have struggled to keep pace with the MSCI World Index, had such a thing existed at the time. Any investment consultant who monitored its performance at the time would have been forced to conclude that it was a slow developer. Later, however, the performance of the fund was to improve dramatically, and as its track record became better known through the efforts of his new partner, Jack Galbraith, who came in to market it, more investors and intermediaries began to take notice. Other firms also began to offer similar global funds, and before too long the mutual fund industry was growing at a furious pace. How, we asked him, did the change to a marketing-backed business come about? Templeton replied, "I was sitting in my office one day and a man came in and said he had been an airplane pilot during the war, but now he wanted to be a salesman. He thought I had a good performance in investments and asked, could he sell my mutual fund? I said, I don't have any money to pay you. And he said, that's all right, I'll just take a commission. His name was John Galbraith. And he started out by taking performance charts of my fund in Canada, the Templeton Growth Fund in Canada. The charts showing Templeton Growth Fund's extraordinary track record of performance later came to be known inside his firm as the Mountain, in recognition of its succession of soaring peaks. According to Templeton's biographer, Jack Galbraith was a trained accountant who had spent a number of years working in the fund industry before approaching Templeton with a proposal to help market his fund. In Templeton's account, his wife ran everything except the calling on brokers, which he did himself. He would walk into a broker's office and see somebody who wasn't busy and sit down beside them and say, tell me what mutual fund has the best results. They would name some firm, and he would say, look at this, and show them the chart of the Templeton Growth Fund. That caught their attention, and so a large number of them began to sell the fund to clients. He paid them a commission, and he kept a commission for himself. It worked like magic. According to Templeton's official biographer, Robert Herman, Galbraith had originally proposed a deal under which he could eventually acquire the fund's management company if he succeeded in increasing the assets of the fund tenfold over 10 years. Templeton declined this offer, but instead suggested that Galbraith acquire 20% of the fund's management company at the outset. This the latter did, although not before telling his wife that he had been disappointed to have ended up with only half a loaf instead of the whole loaf he had wanted. The management company stake was to become worth many millions of dollars and make Galbraith a very wealthy man. It was, ironically, only in the 1970s, however, as Galbraith and his wife began to build a larger marketing team, that the Templeton Growth Fund began consistently to outperform the market. Until that point, its track record had been impressive in absolute terms, but still had a tendency to underperform the markets it was investing in. It was during this period that Templeton began to invest heavily in the Japanese stock market, a contrarian move that was to play a large part in establishing his later reputation. At the height of this phase in its life, the Templeton Growth Fund had as much as 60% of its assets in Japanese stocks. Yet at the time, few professional investors would touch Japan, so little known or understood was the country. Having visited scores of countries on his regular travels abroad, and with an insatiable appetite for new information and experiences, John Templeton was ideally qualified to introduce thousands of American investors to the benefits of investing in international stocks. Templeton's partnership with Jack Galbraith proved a huge commercial success. Within 4 years, the Templeton Fund range, later expanded from the Growth Fund to incorporate a number of other funds managed on the same principles, had grown in size from $13 million to $100 million. By the 1980s, helped by the pro-business policies of the Reagan administration and the onset of the greatest bull market of the 20th century, the fund was measuring its assets in billions rather than millions of dollars. By the time the business was sold to Franklin Resources in 1992, the firm had assets of.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.